Welcome to Purgatorio, the 14th century poem written by Dante Alighieri. This is a follow-up to his groundbreaking allegory, Inferno. Throughout this series, we will be going over history, theology, and even medieval science to provide a detailed context of the story that Dante was trying to tell. Here on the channel, we've already covered Inferno. If you're joining us for the first time, I thoroughly recommend you go back and watch that series first, as it will directly inform this series. Let's set forth on this journey through purgatory together. Dante and Virgil are out of the fires of hell and are standing on the outskirts of a seemingly serene island. Dante is on the exact opposite side of the world that he was at the beginning of Inferno. He is currently peering across the horizon of the uninhabited southern hemisphere of the Earth. Water gently laps the shores of the island, and small bulges of foliage grow on patches of wet sand. Dante describes that he feels like he is now a boat, about to finally cross into calm water. Dante speaks to the audience directly. He informs us of what he is about to present to us in Purgatorio. He is going to describe to us a place in which the human spirit cures itself, as opposed to a place where, in his words,
pitiful magpies felt so sharp a blow that they despaired of ever being pardoned.
A starry night lights up a soon-to-be-dawn sky. It glows dimly in a deep sapphire blue. Dante peers at the constellations above him and sees four brightly shining stars gleaming to the south. He describes them as incredibly old enough to be visible by Adam and Eve, but sadly, no one since.
O Northern Hemisphere, you are a widow to be deprived of any sight of them.
An elderly man is standing nearby to the two poets. Dante pays heed to the man's wise and commanding appearance. He says this man deserves the reverence which all sons give to their fathers. His head is framed by the four stars to the south, and Dante says that their bright glow makes him look like he's facing the sun. The man has been watching our poets as they climbed from the abyss. He suddenly yells questions towards Dante in a stern fashion. He demands answers on Dante's impossible escape from hell.
Who are you, whom going against the current of the blind stream, have escaped the eternal prison? Whom did you have as a lamp to bring you out of the profound night which always darkens the eternal valley?
The man continues, adamantly questioning if the laws of hell have been broken. Have the rules been changed by the will of heaven? He wishes to know by whose authority Dante finds himself in this cleansing place. Virgil makes Dante kneel to the man, with his head bowed in deference. The guide explains to the man that a woman of heaven sent him to bear Dante company on an unprecedented journey.
I showed him all the wicked people. Now I have in mind to show him all those spirits who cure themselves here under your care.
Dante is still living, Virgil says, but was close to death through madness. Now, Dante seeks liberty and to be saved, and he will do what he can to help him be saved. Virgil identifies the man as Cato, and he states that he knows Cato's true love, Marcia, who resides in Limbo, where he himself resides. Virgil promises to send Cato's condolences to Marcia in return for his blessing of passage. Cato looks at Virgil with suspicion. He replies that Marcia no longer has power over him through love because she resides beyond the impassable rivers of darkness. However, if Virgil is under the instruction from a messenger of heaven, then that is all the authority the poets will ever need to pass.
It would not do to go before the ministers of paradise with the eyes dulled by any kind of mist.
Cato orders Virgil to make sure Dante is cleaned up for the journey ahead. All traces of filth must be washed away. Virgil leads Dante downwards to the base of the island, and the sun begins to rise. The early sunlight brightens up a gentle slope, leading back upwards, and Dante follows the incline with his eyes. He is surprised to, for the first time, see a great mountain at the island's center. Virgil kneels beside a patch of grass and gestures for Dante to wash his face with the dewdrops that rest upon it. The water immediately restores to life Dante's complexion, which was hidden under the tears and paleness of the inferno. Virgil next grabs a reed from another plant and fashions it into a belt to replace the one that Dante lost in hell. The sun is already beginning to rise above the horizon, and Dante speaks of the orange sunset of Jerusalem. This is his first reference to his earth clock, where he compares the time of day in purgatory relative to the sun's position in other places of the world. The earth clock is a way for Dante to continually remind the readers that purgatory is a real world place. Purgatory is a place of redemption in the earthly realm. It is where people go to cleanse their souls of sin before being welcomed into heaven. It is very important to clarify that purgatory is the only afterlife which is not eternal. When the end times come and the earth is wiped clean, purgatory will also be destroyed. Purgatory is on the earth, and therefore subject to the earth's fate. Our living poet looks out to the ocean and sees the red light of Mars faintly glowing inside the mist above the water. Then, he sees it. A bright light swiftly flying towards him through the mist, quicker than anything he has ever seen fly. Virgil remains quiet until the glowing he sees takes on the unmistakable shape of wings. He immediately orders Dante down to his knees.
It is an angel of God. Put your hands together. From now on, you will see such officers. See how he scorns all human implements. He does not wish to have any other sail between such distant shores than his own wings. See how he has them straight against the sky, striking the air.
With the angel fast approaching, Dante averts his eyes to stop from being blinded by heavenly light. It reaches the shore, and our poets discover that it is accompanied by a boat, which it was guiding to the island. The boat which the angel brought to purgatory appears so perfectly crafted that it doesn't interact with the water around it. Sat aboard are more than 100 souls, yet it doesn't ripple or displace any liquid. Dante's fascination is quickly drowned out by the spirits aboard the vessel. They are singing. Together they chant the words to "During the Departure of Israel from Egypt." This is a song about escaping from the oppressive bonds of Egypt to the freedoms and plenty beyond. A metaphor for escaping the bonds of sin to the moral and spiritual freedoms of heaven. The heavenly presence floating above the shore makes the sign of the cross, forcing all the souls off the boat and onto the island. It then leaves with the boat, just as quickly as it arrived. The sudden crowd of people wander around the sands near our poets in bemusement, before approaching to speak with them.
If you know where the way is, then show us how we shall go to the mountain.
You perhaps may think we are people familiar with this place, but we are in fact strangers, as you are. We came just now by another way.
The souls become fixed on Dante, noticing that he is breathing, and therefore alive. One by one they halt their drive to climb Purgatory's mountain, and they stare at him. One of the souls breaks from the group, and tries to hug Dante. Our poet is moved by feeling enough to return the gesture, but when Dante reaches out to hold the spirit, he only ends up pressing against his own chest. The living cannot touch the spiritual form of the dead. The breakaway soul smiles at Dante, and our poet realizes who he has been trying to embrace. The spirit is named Kaseya, and he was a singer, a composer, and a good friend to Dante. Dante is confused though. He inquires as to why it took so long for Kaseya to arrive in purgatory. He died many months ago. Kaseya replies that the angel who collects and guides the dead picks and chooses souls as it wishes for each voyage.
So I, who had turned to the seashore, there, where the water of the Tiber grows salt, was received by him. To that estuary he now directs his wings, because it is there that everyone is received who is not to sink to Acheron.
Dante petitions his friend to sing the love song which was always able to soothe him. Kaseya's voice rings across the shore, and for a short time there's a moment of hypnotic content amongst everyone present. Even Virgil finds himself lost in Kaseya's sweet music, at least until Kato catches wind of the noise.
What are you doing? What dwarling is there here? Run to the mountain and strip the outer skin which stops God being manifest in you.
So I saw the band of newcomers abandon the song and go to the hillside, like people going without knowing where they will get to. Our own departure was no less rapid.
Dante keeps close to Virgil. He speaks of how he would not get very far without his master to guide his way. The pair are proceeding to start the climb with a red sun brightly shining at their backs. Dante looks down and sees the darkened ground of his shadow touching the earth from his feet. He realizes that his companion is not casting a shadow and stops in a panic. Virgil smiles and asks Dante if he felt like he was suddenly alone on the mountain. He tries to comfort his charge with his words.
It is already evening in Naples. There lies buried the body within which I made a shadow.
Virgil becomes troubled when explaining that the reason for why he doesn't have a shadow is unclear. As to how it is confusing that a spirit can still suffer from heat and cold without a body. He postulates that God's reasoning is beyond the understanding of man, and to think otherwise would perhaps be madness. His questions of reason remind him of his friends Aristotle and Plato, who suffer from the same unanswered questions in limbo. The pair reach the foot of the mountain and discover a steep and impassable rock face between them and the path upwards.
The most deserted, the most broken down road compared to this is like an open and convenient stairway.
Virgil seeks out a path and then jibes about how they are to continue without first growing a pair of wings. Dante looks around the area and by chance spots a large group of people on the ledge above them. The crowd is moving very slowly far off in the distance. Virgil shouts out to the souls wandering on the tier above. They approach the edge like a flock of sheep, placing their eyes downwards to the earth. One of the souls becomes intrigued by Dante casting a shadow on some nearby grass. In tandem, the rest of the flock begins to notice as well.
Without you asking, I will confess to you that this is a human body that you see. That is why the sunlight on the ground is broken.
The leading soul asks Dante if he recognizes him. Dante gazes as closely as he can at the fair-looking man, but admits loudly that he does not. The soul displays a grave wound above his chest and smiles. His name is Manfred, he yells, the grandson of Empress Constance. Manfred requests that Dante inform his daughter that he is not in hell, and to dispel any false truths that have aroused from his death. Manfred fought in the Battle of Benevento against Pope Clement IV. There, he received fatal wounds. Whilst dying, he repented and gave himself to the mercy of God. Pope Clement IV excommunicated his body outside of papal territory, and Manfred snubs the Pope's authority for it.
My sins were horrible indeed, but infinite goodness has so wide an embrace that it takes everyone that turns to it.
The smiling spirit describes a special punishment to those that die with their hearts set against the church. They must wait 30 times the length of their sin on the shores of purgatory before they can begin their climb. If they receive prayers, those sentences can be shortened. Manfred asks Dante to tell his daughter to pray for him.
For here, advancement comes from those elsewhere.
The souls in purgatory are what we call in this series, penitents. Penitents are sinners who died with great piety for God. Most of this piety takes the form of asking for forgiveness for their sins. Purgatory comes from the Latin verb meaning to cleanse. It's synonymous with the origin of the word purge. Pious sinners are sent to purgatory to purge their souls of sin, so that they can then enter heaven. There is no route from purgatory to hell. Everyone in purgatory will eventually be saved before the earth is destroyed. If it takes a penitent 1,000 years to purge their sin, it takes them 1,000 years. The fascinating tale of Manfred causes Dante to completely lose track of time. The sun has risen 50 degrees into the sky already. Dante speaks against one of Plato's theories, namely that a human can have more than one soul. He postulates that if man had more than one soul, the passage of time would be clear, because not all souls would be fixated on the same thing at the same time. The group of souls above our poets have found an obscure pathway up the mountain. It is sufficient enough that Dante and Virgil can climb and continue. The pathway and opening is so narrow, though, that the two poets have to travel in single file.
We were climbing inside the split rock and had to squeeze between the two sides. The ground needed our hands as well as our feet.
The pier emerged to a wide expanse of hillside, and the living poet asks which way they should go from there. Virgil responds bluntly by saying that they must do nothing now but climb the mountain. The mountain above them seems to be endless, with its peak completely out of view. They climb up a steep 45 degree incline, and Virgil begins to speedily pull away from his exhausted charge. Dante shouts to his mentor so that he isn't left behind, each extra step a toil for him. Virgil turns and sees his companion now a fair distance below him. He points Dante to a flat terrace encircling the mountain, just a little more distance away. With a last gasp of energy, Dante pushes himself to Virgil's side on the ridge, and the pair both sit down to rest. That's it for episode 1, thanks for watching. What did you think about it? Let us know in the comments. If you're new to us here at Aspect History, why not check out one of our other videos linked right here. As always, I've been Circle Strafe, and I'll see you in the next episode. Toodles!